Take two. Campfire Revival. This is day 66 of our 100-day plan, and the bugs are flying in my eyes because we are in Georgia. I was just in Idaho yesterday, so excited to be back in Georgia now. Excuse me while I remove this bug from my eye. Anyway, we are gathered up for the American Campfire Revival. This is day 66 of our 100-day plan. And my heart has been heavy and burdened for God to hear our prayers. And I know that He's hearing our prayers, and I know that He has purpose in all of the difficulties and the challenges that we're facing in our country and in our families and within the family of faith. And so there's great hope and there's great strength when we gather together like this. So let's pray together. Father, thank You for gathering us together all over the country one more time on this 66th day of our plan. And our plan really, Lord, doesn't rely on our strength, because we're just small little creatures in Your big world. And Lord, we don't have a lot of political power. We don't have a lot of strength in the ways that the world would define strength, but You are our strength, and You are our power, and You are our help in time of need. And so we come to You tonight, and we ask You to look upon Your world and look upon Your people. You know what we need, Lord. Direct Your thoughts to us, hear our prayers, and we ask You to heal our hearts and to heal our land. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's an honor and a joy to be with you again. I'm back at my buddy's house. Ed and Susan have whipped up a campfire, and it's exciting to be with you. I just got back from Idaho, and you're never going to believe this, but there was somebody in the airport that saw me wearing the American Campfire Revival sweatshirt, and I had the mask over my face, right? So I look like this, so nobody can tell it's me, but they saw, they couldn't see it was me, but they saw the revival, and they said, "Are you Kirk?" And I pulled off my mask. I said, "Yeah." They said, "Oh, we've been watching. We're there. We're part of the family of faith. We're praying with you and with everybody out there. And this is so good. And keep doing this." So you guys, people are paying attention. They're hearing. And the fires of revival are spreading. It's very exciting. The not so exciting part about my trip is that I left my entire suitcase full of my clothes and everything else that was important for this trip behind in another hotel. And I'm trying to get that shipped out to me. So I had to go to Dick's Sporting Goods and get myself a clean shirt. And I ended up getting a Georgia Bulldog shirt in honor of being here in the Peach State. So on the airplane, I was reading some poetry that my daughter posted on Instagram. And I was blown away by the way it gripped my heart in relation to some of the things that I've been thinking and feeling as we've been talking and praying and working through together. This idea of revival and God meeting us at a time of need. I want to read a poem to you from my daughter, Olivia, and I'll post her poem up on my page as well after I read this to you. And she wrote this. Olivia's my youngest daughter, and she writes lots of poems. Here's one. She said, "Even though my heart sometimes beats rebelliously, I stopped wanting a lot of things when I realized I don't yet know if God wants those things for me. I'm slowly learning to hold each moment with open palms, ready to gracefully receive or set it free." And that really spoke to me, because do you ever feel like there's things that you want and you wonder why God doesn't give them to you? Do you say, Lord, I've been praying about this, but you're not giving it to me. What else do I need to do? Do I need to speak in another language? Do I need to stand on my head? Do I need to do some sort of a trick? And my daughter's pointing out, wait a minute. Maybe there are things that we want that God is not wanting for us to have right now, because His perfect wisdom has a plan that will produce even better results than what we have in mind. And so she's saying, let's open my hands up so that I'm not trying to grab onto the things that I have that I don't want to lose. And I'm not trying to grasp for things that maybe God doesn't want me to have right now. Instead, I'll just keep my hands open and I'll receive what the Lord gives me, because I know it's good because it comes from Him. And I'll set things free if it's time for the season to pass, because God has something new in mind. And that just sort of gives me a sense of peace and rest. I don't know if y'all can see this smoke, but it's just like I'm turning in to Kirk Jerky in front of you. But I love that idea that God has thoughts that are wiser than our thoughts. And instead of trying to grasp and grab onto and hold everything that we think we need, let's let the Lord give and take as He wants, because His thoughts are so good. And then, of course, this made me think of a verse that is a favorite verse for many of us. Maybe this is a verse that is one of your life verses, Jeremiah 29:11, which says this, and I want to speak about this verse and the context in which it was written, and then the context for us today, because a lot of people misinterpret this verse. Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. And then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me, and you will find me when you search for me with all of your heart." I love that verse. It's important for us to know that verse was a verse that Jeremiah had spoken to the people, the Jewish people, when they were in captivity. They were slaves in Babylon, and they were doubting and despairing and wondering if they would ever see the promises of God come to fulfillment. And no doubt they were concerned about the judgment that they were under, because they had sinned against God and forgotten about Him, and they had not kept their sacred covenants with the Lord. Well, listen to this verse, and I want to say to you that the same God who loved His people under the old covenant order, the Jewish people in Babylonian captivity, has an unchanging heart of love and compassion for His people who come to Him by faith today. Isn't that right? Isn't that right, Pastor?
1,000%.
1,000%. I got the pastor stamp of approval. His unchanging heart of love for His children states these things in our context today if we understand it. Now, let me break this down for you. He says, "I know the thoughts that I have toward you." Sometimes you and I don't know God's thoughts toward us. We don't. We wonder. We say, "Lord, what are you thinking? I mean, I know what I want you to do, but that's not what is happening. So I don't understand your thoughts about me and my life." But here's the good news. God does. He knows His thoughts of you, about you. And not only does He think of you and me, the scriptures say that His thoughts are toward us. They're not only thinking of us, He is thinking His thoughts toward us. Charles Spurgeon, one of my very favorite preachers, said that the thoughts of God are continually drifting toward you. He's moving His thoughts in a U-word direction because His eyes are on you. His ears are attentive to you and your prayers, and His thoughts about you are moving toward you. And He says they're thoughts of peace and not evil. The people of Israel easily could have thought that because they were under the judgment of God due to their disobedience, that He had evil plans for them, that this was going to be the end of them. And He says, no, you don't understand my thoughts. In fact, I have you here in captivity for a very important reason. And my thoughts for you, I know them well. They're moving toward you. And my thoughts of you are for peace, and they're not for evil. He said they're to give you a future and a hope. God has a future and God has a hope because God is a God of hope. He is the Prince of Peace. Then what's the deal? Why, Lord, are we in this place of discipline or judgment or trial or captivity? And the good news is that God defines his future and hope in mind for his people as we go on. He says, and then he says, you will call upon me and you will pray to me and I will listen to you. You see, they were in captivity and they didn't have access to their temple to be able to go and pray to their God and for him to hear them in their temple. And he's saying, I still hear you. I still hear you. I hear your prayers. And he says, I have a purpose for you in this difficult trial and challenge that you're in. Just think of Daniel in the lion's den. Think of the people who have been in difficult situations. The Lord had prepared them in those difficult places for other things he had in mind for them, for their future. And those people would end up being a source of help and hope for others. And it turns out that God had the Jewish people in Babylonian captivity partly so that they would scatter and there would be a proliferation of new synagogues, new houses of worship, and there would be the proliferation of the Old Covenant scriptures in preparation for when the gospel would come and there would be little anchors all over, little houses of worship where the gospel could be spread through those synagogues. God has amazing thoughts that are higher than our thoughts and ways that are more brilliant than our ways. And he says, you'll seek me and you'll find me when you search for me with all of your heart. The good news there is that God's not hiding from us. You will search for me and you'll find me because God is a God who reveals himself to us. I'm sorry, I don't mean to get all crazy and preach to my phone here while you're listening. I just want to share with you what's encouraged me, and that is God's not hiding from us. He's not back there going, muhaha, muhaha, I've got you in this place and I enjoy seeing you struggle. I don't think so. I think as a loving father who cares about his children, he has let his children know in the past, and his unchanging heart speaks to us today, that his thoughts are toward us. He knows what those thoughts are. They include peace and not evil, and they include a future, and they include a hope. And part of that is that he listens to our prayers. And part of that is that he's not hiding. He reveals himself to us when we come to him in repentance and faith. So let's lay down our defenses against God and believing his word. Let's just stop making weapons against the promises of God or finding excuses to disregard the words and the commands of God. And let's search for him with all of our heart and say, God, help me understand. Give me wisdom. Open my eyes. Open my ears. Lord, help me take down all of my defenses. I want to find you. Will you reveal yourself to me and reveal your plans for me and help me understand your thoughts toward me so that I can lift my hands in gratitude and in worship? I think that's the formula that is going to bring about revival. And that's what we're hoping for. That's what we're praying for. Lord, send us revival. Because I know that the thoughts of God are to pour new life into dead hearts and dead marriages and dead homes and a nation that appears to be flatlining in so many ways. And the resuscitation, the resurrection, the new life, the revival of the country begins in the reviving of your heart and mine. There's a little bug that just flew out from one of the little demons from the pit below. He tried to get in my ear. I didn't let him. That is the source of our life. That's the source of our hope. That's the source of our future. The one who loves us, who made us. Lord, send the fires of revival. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Will you make sure that you don't let your head hit the pillow tonight before you ask God to reveal his thoughts to you, and that you ask him to help you search him with all of your heart so that you can find him and you can be friends with him and walk with him where he wants you to go. God bless you guys. See you tomorrow night.